over it, and you don't have to worry about taking the stuff home or anything else. Alright. A lot of the first chapter, even parts of the second, are a lot of definitions. So you get a good understanding, a good base to work with. And I'm gonna ask you questions like this. I'm gonna have you determine whether it's a population or a sample, and then give me the sample and the population pertaining to that problem. So a survey of 1,502 US adults found that 78% favor government policies requiring better fuel efficiency for vehicles. You ask yourself this, are there more US adults?
Yes.
Yes, so this is your sample. So this is your sample, 502 US adults. And my population, all US adults. What is 78% favor that policy? That's your descriptive statistic. That is your descriptive statistic about that particular group. Okay? You made an inference about the population based on your sample. So after you sampled, you found those 78% favored, you make the inference about the whole population. Okay. 38 nurses working in the San Francisco area were surveyed concerning their opinions of managed health care. Are there more than 38 nurses in the San Francisco area?
Yes.
Yes, so this is a sample. However, they're nurses from San Francisco. Not all nurses in the United States. I'm only looking to represent nurses in San Francisco. So my population is all nurses in San Francisco. And I survey them for what they feel about managed health care. A survey of 2,311 U.S. adults found that 84% have seen a healthcare provider at least once in the past year. I asked myself, are there more U.S. adults? Yep, then this is a sample. My population is all U.S. adults. My 84% have seen a healthcare provider is what?
A
descriptive statistic. From my sample, I asked them what they've done, and I make an inference about the population. I can't possibly ask every U.S. adult if they've seen a health provider in the past year. So I use my sample to make an inference about my population. A survey of 186 U.S. adults aged 25 to 29 found that 76% have read a book in the past 12 months. So I say, are there other U.S. adults aged 25? Yeah, this is my sample. My sample is age 25 to 29. My population is U.S. adults age 25 to 29. I have a specific population, not just any adult. My descriptive statistic after I surveyed them, 76% have read a book in the past 12 months. Give me an inference you take out of this. If we did the survey and we found that 76% of U.S. adults from 25 to 29 years old have read a book in the past 12 months. Give me an inference about that. What do you take away from that? What does that call out to you?
Three?
Yeah, love this guy. What does that like infer to you? Nikita? How are you?
I missed it.
More than half of U.S. adults aged 25 to 29 have read a book. Yeah?
And about 24% of them either never read a book or read more than one.
Probably haven't read a book. 22% haven't read a book in the past, 74% haven't read a book in the past 12 months.
Yeah, scratch that other possibility.
Mm-hmm. But what is that saying to you? Like, Nikita had a good point. More than half of them have read a book. So are our young adults staying literate?
Yes.
Are they reading? Yeah, I'm happy with that number. I'm happy that 76% of young adults figure from 25 to 29, where are you in your life? Coming out of college, young career, right? So that 76% of our young adults are still finding time to read a book. I think that's a good percentage, don't you? What do you think, Peter? Go put your phone away while we review. Okay, parameter or statistic? I should say or statistic. In 2012, Major League Baseball teams spent a total of a heck of a lot of money on player salaries. Heck of a lot of money. Pathetic. Yeah. We are in such a deficit yet, look at what these players make. Okay, parameter. Why is this a parameter? No.
It's all the
NBA and all the MLB baseball teams. MLB baseball teams. Good. But did it say all the teams? No, we had to kind of pull that out. It didn't say some. It didn't say a sample of. So yeah, they're kind of referring to all the baseball teams in Major League Baseball. In a recent study of math majors at a university, 10 students were minoring in physics. Statistic, because of the 10? Okay, so those that put statistic, did you use the 10? What is the 10? 10 is what I found from looking at this group. 10 is my descriptive parameter or statistic in this case, whichever it happens to be. But what am I looking at?
Math majors at university.
Math majors. I feel that it's all math majors, right? It doesn't tell me that.
At a university. It wouldn't be like every university?
Nope. You can just do at your university, at your school. I could do seniors at my school. That's my population. Nurses in San Francisco, that's my population.
So if you're doing like math majors at a university, like wouldn't all the other majors be the population?
Nope. Just your math majors. You're taking all the math majors and you're asking them. So technically, the population is all math majors.
The sample would be like some of them.
Some of them. Maybe I surveyed some, but probably I looked at all math majors at universities. And out of all of my math majors, this is what they told me. 10 were minoring in physics. Okay. What does that infer to me? Me, I would think that number would be a lot higher. Out of all your math majors, I went to a technical college, and it was like science and math and computers. And I had to take physics, I had to take math, I had to take computers, obviously. But that's what I majored in, computers. But I had to take physics 1, physics 2, I had to take calculus 1, 2, and 3. So I was a computer major, but I still had to take physics, which would seem to me a lot of math majors should be taking physics. I would think there's a little something off with this. I don't know. But those are things that you're going to think about and think where they come from. This is kind of like the question about the nurses in the Boston area, wherever, San Francisco area. I don't have to look at every nurse. I could just look at nurses in Newburgh, and that's my population. My sample comes from that group. So all my math majors, I asked a question and I got this result. Which part of the survey in example 3 represents a descriptive? We talked about that descriptive as we went through. The one that describes. Okay, qualitative or quantitative? Remember, this has the word
quantity.
These deal with numbers. This has the word
quality.
That doesn't have the numbers in there. Okay. All right. What are the four levels, by the way?
Nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio.
Good. Of these four, which ones are qualitative?
Nominal.
Anything else?
Ordinal.
Ordinal can sometimes. Ordinal can be either. Depends if they assign numbers to them, if they rank them. These two are what?
Quantitative.
Quantitative. Okay. So, the ages of a sample of 350 employees at a software company. Quantitative. What level of measurement is it?
Ratio.
Ratio. Go for the highest one. So if you say ages could be ordinal, I put them in an order, yeah. I have an interval. I could say you're 2 years older than me. Can I make a ratio? Can I compare them? Make it a fraction. Make it a, think of half. That usually helps kids think of it better. If they're, he's 25 and I'm 50. He's half, I'm twice as old. He's half as old as me. Yes.
So can you do ratios and numbers
of like, close together? Absolutely. So, if you're at 10 and I'm 30, you're three, I'm three times older than you, right? Or you're one third my age, right? If you're 10 and I'm 12, I still have the same ratio type thing. I just have a fractional part. It's one, instead of one third, it's 5/6 the proportion. It's like a ratio, it's a proportion. So if you can make some kind of proportion, I usually stick with the halves and the doubles because that's what kids see better. Then when I say 10 and 12, I'm only 2 years apart, but I'm 5/6.
You're
5/6 my age.
You can do 10 and 12, that's
not. Absolutely. If you can do 10 and 30, you can do 10 and 12. The revenues of the companies on a Fortune 500 list. They're quantitative. What level of measurement is it? Ratio. Can I say one company makes twice as much, half as much, third, quarter? How about if I said the names of the companies? Oops.
That's nominal.
The names of the companies, nominal. Good. How about if I said the top five companies?
Ordinal.
Ordinal. Good. Okay. You're quick, Brandon, quick. I couldn't even write that fast. Okay. Time and temperature are good examples, but be careful. Time measured in minutes, how many minutes, how many hours, is ratio. Time span is interval. Temperatures, think of your thermometer. You can have a difference between your temperatures. Zero has a temperature. It doesn't mean none. Zero has a temperature. So I can have a difference in my temperature, but I can't say yesterday was twice as hot. We say it, we're like, oh my God, it's twice as hot as yesterday. It was like five times hotter than yesterday, but we have no way to measure that. So daily temperatures are interval. Vehicle sizes for a class of sedans are listed from lowest to highest. This is ordinal. The four departments of a printing company are listed. Nominal. Why is this not ordinal? There's no order to it. We just listed the companies. No order to it. The total compensation in millions of the top 10 CEOs at the U.S. are listed in millions. Ratio. Are we good with that? For what? For this one?
For
18. 18? Okay, so ordinal because there is an order. Interval, let's go a little step higher. Can I say that this company, the CEO, made $3 million more than this one? I have a difference. Can I say that from here to here, this one made almost three times as much? From here to here? So start with what you think and then say, can I go up one? Can I give it an interval? Can I even say ratio? And again, like Nicholas pointed out, we have a harder time seeing when it's not exactly a half, but make them work out to be a half. Like make them to be like almost three times, almost half as much, almost a quarter as much. Start with what you think and work your way up. When you can't go any further, then you reach your highest level. Okay, observational or experimental? So your first one, Researchers conduct a study to determine whether a drug used to treat hypothyroidism works better when taken in the morning or taken at bedtime. To perform the study, 90 patients are given one pill to take in the morning and one pill to take in the evening, one containing the drug and the other containing a placebo. After 3 months, patients are instructed to switch pills. Experiment. Where's the control group? The placebo, how many groups do I actually have? I have one group. So what I'm testing is I know they all have hypothyroidism. And my testing is this pill better in the morning? Is this pill better in the evening? So I don't want them to know. I want them to take it. But then I'm going to obviously monitor their thyroid levels or whatever medical things I have to do. And see if it's better for them to have taken it in the morning or to have taken it in the evening. You can have an experiment and have your control group be the same as your experimental group. I just did everything the exact same to them and then switched them. Okay, so here's an experiment. Researchers conduct a study to determine the number of falls women had during their pregnancy. To perform the study, researchers contacted 3,997 women who had just given birth and asked them how many times they fell. Observation. Even though we're not physically looking at them, we're asking them, did you fall? How many times did you fall? Are we influencing this? Are we having two groups? No. We're just sending them a survey and say, how many times did you fall? Okay. And yeah, it sounds like a silly question, but when you're pregnant, your equilibrium is, your center of equilibrium is different. So that is a pretty decent question. Okay. Your sampling techniques. Remember, you don't want bias in there. Bias is something that you have made a difference in. Using random digit dialing, researchers asked 1,003 U.S. adults their plans on working during retirement. This is your simple random sampling. Assign a number, use a table, generate from your calculator, assign everybody a number. And their bias has changed over the years because back in the day, everybody had a landline, so it was easier just to make phone calls that way. Now it's not so easy because a lot of people don't have phones. And what's happening with your cell phones is you all don't have the same 3-digit prefix, right? Everybody pretty much has a different prefix. It used to be if I wanted to call everybody like from Uber, I would call 562, the 561, the 564, the 565, so then we went to 863. We've grown. So my calling is going to be within there. But if I can't reach you because you don't have a landline and you have a cell phone, you have a 234, you have a 764, a 317. Everybody's got different prefixes. So it's a little tougher. That's why you don't get too many of those calls yet. You will soon, but not too many. A student asked 18 friends to participate in a psychology experiment. This is your convenience. This is where your bias is. They're your friends. So if you're asking them psychological questions, they're your friends because you have a lot of similarities. A pregnancy study in Cebu, Philippines randomly selects 33 communities from the Cebu metropolitan area and then interviews all the pregnant women in these communities. If you're going to take some districts, some areas, and interview all in that area, this is a cluster. Think of your stars. When you see that stars clustered together, you're looking at all the stars here. You're not looking in between, and then you're going to pick this group over here and look at this cluster of stars. Cluster. There might be a little bit of bias. I don't feel that there's any bias. I don't feel there's bias. I feel this was more, the book gives this as bias. I don't. I think if you're, as long as you're doing this randomly, granted, you might not get a sample that represents your population, but I think it's not due to bias. It's just the randomness of it happening. Law enforcement officials stop and check the driver of every third vehicle. Every third, this is your systematic. Okay. Again, the book says there's bias because it may be close to a bar. Who would guess that? I would not say that. I think instead of this part, they should worry about, are they doing this systematically? And it is every third. Absolutely. I feel there's no bias. Did you guys find bias in these?
I found bias in 2080. They could have went through, they could have just went through security.
Yeah, there is bias in 2080.
Probably if they're about to get on a plane, they're not too worried about air travel.
Yeah. Well, they are, right? They're definitely worried about air travel.
I mean, like, not scared of Disney.
Yeah, that could be too, on that flip side. Okay, let's hit 27. 25 students are randomly selected from each grade level. 25. Did I take all the students from each grade level? Just a sample from every area. This is your stratified. Okay. This one, yeah, we determined bias because either they feel real strongly one way or the other because they're about to board a plane. Using the fifth row of table one, could you generate your numbers? Did you get these numbers? Between 1 and 650? Did you get those numbers, guys?
Mm-hmm.
How many digits did you have to go every?
Three.
It might take you a little bit longer because 650 is, I don't know, right in the middle, but it might take a little bit longer to get there. Okay. You want to know the favorite spring break destination among 15,000 students at a university? Determine whether you would take a census or a sampling. And if you would use a sampling, how would you do it? If you have 15,000 students at your university, are you going to ask the whole population or are you going to ask a sample?
I'm going to ask the whole population.
How would you do that?
Survey.
And where would you get that survey to? How would you do that? It's possible.
I'm try to post it online and the like position that we're going in.
But how would you reach every student, is what I'm asking.
Those are the methods.
Well, you're at your university, and you're just you in a specific class, and you need to survey every student in that pool. How do you reach them all?
Oh my goodness. I just told you. Sorry, but I just told you.
Oh. You post something of where? On the district website? On where? Well, what I'm asking is this. What? I'm having a hard time the other day, and I don't really know the
website. No, you can post that simple.
I'm
going to
get an absolute answer.
Okay.